What I'm about to present to you will seem extremely far-fetched, a reconciliation of strange design choices that reaches far beyond its own grasp, and in all honesty, probably has no basis in reality. Authorial intent does not always equate success, as we know, and eyes are so often bigger than stomachs. For this particular game, a community has been polarized between the two, caught in a limbo state between a legacy of expectation and a desire to craft its own identity. This game has ended up skirting the borders between masterpiece and abomination, a perfect storm of indulgence, expensive tech, and an all-out attempt to recreate something that probably only ever really existed in our heads. But still, I remain convinced that there's something else going on here. Something that makes peace between disparate elements to create an experience that might not be exceptional, but is nonetheless intentional, and compels me to ask... Corporate fascism, eco-terrorism, the overwhelming sense of dread that comes with fighting an empire that has literally built itself on top of you. You know, that big fucking pizza. The story of Final Fantasy VII is a story about oppression, a story about life after trauma, and the hope that somehow blooms out of the most desperate situations. It's the story of a city, one as vast and impenetrable as the sky it's blocking out. And then you leave Midgar, and it becomes the story of a genetically enhanced psychopath cutting a bloody trail across the world, eventually triggering an extinction-level event that's only stopped by a literal miracle. Because, you know, that's the only way they could believably paint something as more of a threat than capitalism. Final Fantasy VII is an epic fable about a war between good and evil, between freedom and control, between the planet and the people killing it. It spans countless continents, dozens of hours, and has more than its fair share of shocks and twists along the way. It is a truly iconic part of gaming history, one that is so ambitious and vast that its remake 23 years later only captures a fraction of the story. In Final Fantasy VII Remake, you don't leave Midgar. The story ends as the highway does. There will be more planned, of course, but knowing this going in, I understand the decision. It's a big project, recreating one of gaming's most well-known stories in luscious, decadent definition. By containing it to just the opening city, more time was spent on the smaller details, and the results are often staggering, even if at times a bit mixed. By stretching 10 hours of the original game to 40, more time is allocated to the characters, both familiar and new, and more time is spent in the various sectors of the Undercity, transforming them from stages of the protagonist's great struggles into living, breathing worlds that show what it means to live in Midgar. Not just to survive, but to really live. All the big set pieces are there, and for the most part they are really impressive. Great care has gone into making the boss fights feel fresh and interesting rather than just damage sponges. And there were moments in the game where I genuinely screamed with delight at a recreation of a moment from the original I have come to know intimately at this point. Something had to give, obviously. And on the one major critical consensus, I can't argue against it. For everything added to the world, something is taken from the story. That intangible, vitally important component of all good narratives. Pacing. Final Fantasy VII Remake is a game of stops and starts, of inconsistent run speeds and wedges driven violently into the fable with seemingly little regard for artistic integrity. The moment this is most noticeable comes just after your first foray into War Market. You've had your jollies in a dance-off at the Honeybee Inn, crafted glistening buns of steel with some beefcakes at the local gym, and even fought a giant robot house. A gorgeous dress in tow, you finally infiltrate Don Corneo's mansion, confront the garish sex pest himself, and learn something terrible. In an attempt to wipe out your organization for good, the Shinra Electric Company are going to drop a plate onto Sector 7. Time is of the essence here, and after being dropped Wile E. Coyote style into the sewers, you make your hurried journey back to your allies, who are no doubt fighting for their lives and the lives of the people of Sector 7. So you spend an hour in the sewers, then another hour pissing around with ghosts in a train graveyard. They aren't even ghost trains, why are they haunting a train graveyard? What once was a brief gauntlet becomes an exhaustive diversion that completely rips the sense of urgency away from the audience. When you eventually return to Sector 7, all hell finally breaks loose, but it feels artificial as a result, as though they are all actors waiting on their marks for the protagonist, so that the show can finally begin. As an aside, can you imagine playing this game with no prior knowledge of the original and suddenly this fucking creature appears out of nowhere, then vanishes for the rest of the game without any explanation or acknowledgement? No one's gonna look at Kate Sith and implicitly think, of course, that's a puppet being controlled by Shinra's head of urban development, Reeve Tuesti. What the actual fuck, Square Enix? This is a problem that follows Remake throughout its playtime. Although not quite as disruptive in other places, it struggles to organically insert its new content. Sometimes it works because the game has changed the nature of the narrative around it, as with Jesse's visit to the upper plate being a nighttime excursion before embarking on a mission. Other times it only serves to make you forget what was even going on before or what your goals were supposed to be. The journey to the Sector 5 reactor in particular is far, far too long, considering already that the two chapters that preceded it were also not in the original game. In isolation, I don't think any one aspect is particularly bad. The sun lamps are a cool idea, even if in execution they don't quite work, and that whole section feels dragged out. The moments of downtime allotted for side quests and spending time with the locals creates a good sense of place, even if it is sometimes at odds with the pacing of the story. Some of the side quests and optional encounters reminded me a lot of the Yakuza games, in that weird ebb and flow of super serious narrative and goofy diversion, although not executed as well. I also really like how the game builds upon the other members of Avalanche. Letting you further into their lives genuinely improves a group of characters that never really got much time on screen in the original. Characterization in the game in general is really good. Some of the dialogue is a bit stilted and naff, and Cloud's voice actor seems to have been given no direction in how to deliver his lines, but there are clearly defined traits in the cast that make them stand out as more than just one-dimensional actors. I even don't really mind a lot of the newer characters, although I don't feel like they are as developed as the main cast. Wildcard motorbike stud Roche is a fucking menace that vanishes as quickly as he enters the story, and premium pickpocket and shit stirrer extraordinaire Kirie feels a bit like an insert designed specifically for the late game side quests and little more. But you have other recurring characters like Miss Folia, the Leafhouse teacher who has dreams of show business, Mireille, the guardian angel of the slums, and the Wall Market trio, all of whom I would argue add more than they take away. Going back to the Yakuza comparison, I would have liked to have seen more done with these characters, for them to have their own miniature arcs, but in most cases they appear once or twice, then all but vanish from the player's cone of vision. The crux of the problem is this. These vignettes work in isolation. These characters and events and general wide net of world building are interesting additions, but as part of a cohesive story, they become a bit of a mess, and the result ends up feeling like a very different kind of game to that of the original. As distinct, I would argue, as a novel is to a film. What you end up with is this idea that Remake isn't really its namesake. It's more of an adaptation of the same source material, and where Final Fantasy VII was a defined story with acts and pacing and structured narrative devices, senses, Remake feels more like it's an attempt to recreate the same world with an extra dimension. It's not a story, but a simulation. And that's the word I want to focus on for the rest of this video. While the additions and downtime present in the game are distinct from the original, they alone aren't the key to understanding what Final Fantasy VII Remake really is, because there are also a lot of really weird elements that don't make sense even in the wider context of the game. The Whispers, spectral guardians of the canon, for example, who only seem to show up to prevent the party from doing things that they probably weren't going to do anyway, and are explained away by Aerith and Red 13 with all the confidence and clarity of someone delivering a school report on a book they didn't read. Cloud's near-constant hallucinations of Sephiroth at key moments in the game seem more like a hurried attempt at a premature presence than a visual representation of a young soldier's trauma, disruptive without necessarily any relevance to the respective scenes. Chadley. Who the fuck is this little goon? He always seems to magically know where you're going to be at any point in the story, and he seems to be able to create materia at will, which goes against the game world's internal logic. There's smaller stuff too, like how the game's materia system and items are explained in-universe in a very pleasing way, but then you can also dive into your weapons and upgrade them using points gained from technical manuals, something referenced by your Avalanche allies but not really given the same reverence as every other system. And finally, the biggest tell. I know it's a huge stretch to avoid the inevitable truth that Remake is just fan service rammed into an otherwise excellent game, but here's my theory. The events of Final Fantasy VII, the entire story from the moment Cloud jumps off that first train to Aerith summoning the Lifestream to bitch slap a meteor, it's already happened. What we're experiencing in-game is a simulation. A digital recreation, God knows how many years into the future, that attempts to make sense of the chaos that took place before. It loses that sense of pace because it's not a story being told, but rather one being experienced. An attempt to unearth a lost history by placing heroes back into the war they swore they were done with. I feel like this theory explains a lot of the weirdness of Final Fantasy VII Remake. At times it feels immersive, while other times it doesn't. When you have your protagonist taking a tour through hyper-real slums dug out of the bowels of an inescapable colossus, but also have them smashing brightly coloured crates in a time attack minigame, how else do you explain away that dissonance? When you have a child scientist that seems to exist outside of time and space, who can magic up brutal simulations where you fight fantastical beasts, but also only talks to and is acknowledged by you, how else do you make peace with this? When the constant presence of the game's big bad, long before his original debut, hangs over the player like a Bashunan spectre, then through some incredibly bullshit Deus Ex Machina. How else would you corroborate that into a narrative where your finale is only really the beginning of a much larger story? The game toys coquettishly with the idea of predestination, showing glimpses of scenes that lie in the future, and it's given this naff elucidation that doesn't really explain anything, because I think maybe Aerith, or whoever it actually is playing her part, knows what's really going on but can't reveal the full truth. Maybe the flash forwards and the whispers are glitches in the simulation, or an attempt to cover up its limitations. and it still begs further questions about what all of this is in aid of. Is there a purpose to the simulation, or is it just an extremely horny version of I have no mouth and I must scream? Are we really even Cloud Strife, or is he just an avatar we use to navigate someone else's world? Are Roche and the other Avalanche and Kyrie and Chadley the Boy Wonder active approximations of real people suspiciously absent from the original game, or fragments of a director's ego inserted on a whim and a gamble? Is Chadley the real mastermind behind the simulation, a curious AI self-insert that acts as an unconscious guide for the player, slacking the reins just enough for a little chaos to enter an otherwise accurate representation of a fictionally historic account? Or am I just giving Tetsuya Nomura more credit than he deserves? When you love a piece of media, and I mean really love it, warts and all, there's a tendency to want to explain away the often valid criticisms of it. That's the point. It's satire. You have to separate the art from the artist. We want to feel like even the things that are blatantly commercial products have an artist's will imposed on every fiber, because we're terrified that loving something that might be an accident or a compromise or even a nakedly cynical addition could be seen as a reflection of who we are, even when it patently is not. Final Fantasy VII Remake is an imperfect creation. It's far too long for the fragment of a tale it's trying to tell. It fails to marry its many disparate parts, and it continues to struggle throughout to hold on to any one particular identity. But in a way, that is its identity, a reflection on the magnitude of its task and the troubled history of the series up until this point. It may not be Final Fantasy VII, but it's definitely something that earns its right to exist, and I certainly won't forget that.